Well, we're 1 week away from the start of the next Arizona legislative session. Last week, we heard from the Senate President and Speaker of the House, both Republicans. Tonight, we hear from Democratic leaders at the Capitol. Joining us is Senate Minority Leader Leah Landrum Taylor and House Minority Leader Chad Campbell. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining
us. Glad to be here.
Thank you.
Let's start with impact. Numbers have changed a little bit. How much impact can Democrats have at the Capitol this go-around?
Well, I think it's going to have a tremendous impact, or it should, quite frankly. And when you look at our numbers versus last year, we were a super minority, and now at this point, even if it's a forcible situation of having conversations and bipartisanship, that's fine. But it really, I would hope that it wouldn't be a situation of force. It should be a situation to where we would want to work together. And there are going to be times where if every member on the Republican side doesn't vote along with rank and file members, there can be situations where, we can definitely make some differences and changes. But again, I would hope that we could work together.
How much difference do you think?
I hope there's going to be some significant changes down there. I think that a lot of it comes down to the governor, though, to be honest with you. I think the governor has to show that she wants to work in a bipartisan way with both sides, Democrats in the Senate and the House. And we can work together on some of the big issues, the Medicaid expansion possibly, education funding, school safety, things like that, that should be nonpartisan issues. But we need to work with the governor as well. And quite frankly, we haven't seen that the past couple of years, so I'm hoping it changes.
I asked the leadership when they were here last week for successes and failures. First success they mentioned, balanced budget. Success?
You know, when I have an opportunity to speak with our schools and our school districts across the state, individuals, families, parents, I'm a parent myself, I have children that are in school, and quite frankly, individuals really and districts are concerned about the amount of cuts that did take place to education. And yeah, so we have a statute, you know, we have to constitutionally finish out with a balanced budget, but it depends on how you perceive that. Is it balanced on the backs of children or on the backs of families or vulnerable adults and those who have mental illnesses? I mean, we can go on down the line. And when we're talking to these various constituencies, there's grave concerns that are going on from DES and, you know, those who receive DES. This is a major problem. Over the last, 5 years, we've had cuts in around $1.5 billion in education alone, soft capital funding wiped out completely. These are the types of things that we have to make sure that we put back in. Overcrowded classrooms, it's not making it a conducive learning environment for our children.
And yet the other side will say that we have put some money back in, not as much as was taken out. It'll take a long trek to get back to those levels in a variety of ways. But education has been targeted and has been refilled to a certain degree.
To a certain degree, and that degree is very, very small. It'd be like if your employer cut your salary by 75% over the past 3 years, and they gave you 5% back and said, oh, look, we gave you a pay raise. We need a long-term plan for the state, be it school funding, be it infrastructure, be it healthcare, whatever it may be. We've seen a bunch of short-sighted decisions over the past couple of years made down there, cutting school funding, cutting healthcare, whatever it may be, cutting law enforcement. We need a long-term plan. And as Leah pointed out, balancing the budget on the backs of children or the seniors or whatever it is, that's not a balanced budget. And that's just a bad, bad plan. We need a long-term plan that invests in the future of the state, and we don't have it right now.
If the budget has to be balanced on a back, whose back is it balanced on?
Well, I don't think it should be balanced on anybody's back. What it should be balanced on and based on is long-term planning. Our tax code is broken, needs to be overhauled. We need a fair tax code that doesn't just benefit special interests or large corporations, but actually helps out small businesses and families. We need a long-term investment strategy for education, job creation, whatever it may be. Shouldn't be balanced on anybody. What it should be done, or how it should be built, is based on a future plan for the state, and we don't have that.
But another idea is that the tax cuts, incentives, credits, these sorts of things, which of course keep less money from coming in, signals to other businesses around the country that Arizona is open for business. Valid?
But at the same time, when you talk to many industries, business industries, they discuss the concern about the amount of money that they have to put into training, retraining workforces. That's a problem. And so when you look at really attract businesses being attracted to a state, also the quality of life is critical, and then how the educational system is so that they can have future workforce pools from there. That's a problem. The cuts that we've had in our universities, having a big impact on things like research. And this makes an incredible difference if a business is really eyeing what's going on here within our state. It's about basic priorities. And in many instances, we have really, it's been failed.
Are you hearing from the business community, business interests, that these are concerns that the legislature, both sides of the aisle, need to address?
You know, one of the things with the, and we certainly have are open to having discussions, talking with the business community, but we've heard this. If you think about high-tech industry, for instance, and the amount of revenue that they have to pour into training and retraining their workforce. At a certain amount of time, as a business owner myself, it comes to a certain point to where, is this something that's helping or hurting your business? If you can go to another state that has everything, then why would you not go there? A great education system, a nice, safe environment. These are the type, quality of life for your employees. These are the things that you look at, and not having to pour all this money into training and retraining your workforce.
I'm just going to add to you. Look, there's good tax cuts, there's good tax credits and there's bad ones. And you got to balance them out. I mean, I had a package 2 years ago that would have lowered the corporate income tax rate because I thought it was too high. But we paid for it by closing some of the loopholes and other parts of our tax code. We can attract business with good tax packages, but just throwing money away out the door with no accountability is not the way to go. And that's what we've seen the last 3 years from this legislature and from this governor.
Are you expecting to see more of that this go around?
Unfortunately, I think we may. And it's very, very bad if we do, because right now we have a surplus for the next couple of years. But 3 years down the road, we're going to be in another hole. And if we keep throwing money away without a long-term strategy for investing and making sure we're meeting the needs of the people, we're going to be right back to where we were at just 2 years ago.
You mentioned the future and possible problems down the line here as far as the budget is concerned. Medicaid expansion is a major issue, and those who are against it are saying that any expansion will lead to future deficits. First of all, is that true?
You know, if we were to take a look at the Medicaid expansion and to get it up to the level, the conversation has been going on about which level do you take it to for the federal poverty level, FPL, 133%. That's been a figure that's been thrown out there. If we don't move in a direction of at least coming together with some type of a consensus and some type of an agreement, in the long run, we can lose federal funds. That can be a major problem to have. And then you still have those populations that have that need for the Medicaid expansion, for those that are, the adults that have a need for that, and as well as the disabled population that need this Medicaid. So the bottom line is the need is not going to go away. It's just how we go about approaching it. And I think this is a good opportunity, if ever, to have bipartisanship coming to the table and having a five caucus talk about it.
But how can you have bipartisanship when a lot of folks, you talk about matching funds, their concern is that the federal government won't even have those funds available. You can't even count on those funds.
That's a red herring. If the federal government doesn't have funds to match Medicaid in this state, then we've got bigger problems in this country than Arizona's particular situation. But I just want to add this, though. If we fund Medicaid, the full expansion, we're going to get about over $2 billion, give or take, in federal money coming down to Arizona within a few years. And that means tens of thousands of jobs in the healthcare sector, ancillary jobs outside of the sector, economic development across the state, most notably in the rural areas that are struggling right now. Yuma is a great example. We need to invest in healthcare, not just because of the healthcare situation itself, but because it puts people back to work.
What does it put the state, though, in terms of responsibility more than a couple of years down the line?
It'll probably be a few hundred million dollars, but I'll tell you what. We gave away $1 billion corporate tax welfare package 2 years ago. We gave away $50 million to private prisons last year. It's a matter of priorities. We have the money. It's where we decide to spend it.
Uncompensated care, an aspect of all this. It's a hidden tax. Everyone seems to agree it's a hidden tax out there. How do you approach it? What do you do?
You know, having the conversation even with hospitals and the amount of uncompensated care that goes on, it's a big concern. And I think a lot of times people have a misperception. They may feel that if you see a hospital and they're building new buildings, obviously things are going great. We have to realize a lot of that is many times endowed or other funding sources that are coming towards that. The big concern is I've even seen it happen in my very own district, where at a certain point of uncompensated care, what happened was the hospital closed, our only hospital that we have within our district. Rural areas, that can be a huge effect if hospitals close. So at the same time, why would we not try to find measures so that individuals can be able to receive the necessary health care and not put our health care system in a crisis mode, and literally, yet, with hospital doors closing.
Indeed, and yet, again, I hear that hospitals, service provider, sending a mixed message with all this capital improvement going on, and yet we can't afford to stay open. Is that a mixed message?
I don't think it's a mixed message. It's a matter of investing in long-term infrastructure for the system that needs to be in place. This is, again, it's a good business model, but for the long-term future of healthcare and hospitals in this state and in this country, we need to invest in Medicaid and the supporting systems that support healthcare overall. If we don't, we're going to see a massive collapse.
And a little bit on that capital improvement. Sometimes it's for safety reasons that, you know, to upgrade for hospitals, it necessitates having that even better equipment in order to make sure that people can get better medical services. But then again, as I said before, in many instances, sometimes that is endowed. It's other sources where that comes from.
The idea of armed guards in schools, the idea of armed teachers, armed administrators, armed anyone on school campuses, K through 12, university, you name it, your thoughts.
I have a really big concern about having that be the case with armed individuals on our campuses not having the proper training for that to occur, perhaps, or maybe someone who has a philosophical difference of not wanting to have a weapon or not. But yet at the same time, would it be a mandate for principals to have it? Who would have it? Would the bullets have to be locked in one area, the weapon in one? How does this all work and mesh? I would see more of looking towards school resource officers. We've had, you know, huge cuts that have happened with our districts, and for a long time we had school resource officers. Perhaps more security that could be where you have the, you know, the cameras in our schools so that we can have them at different points of entrance, you know, to be able to make things a little bit safer. But to just have that as a final end-all solution, again, this is why it's important for when we talk about five caucus talks, it's important for us to sit down with both the House and the Senate side and the governor and to be able to discuss things like that so we can put things forward. That's how you come up with compromise. That's how you come up with agreements. Going into my 15th year in the legislature, I've seen it done before.
The education people are it sounds like their number one interest right now is making sure that whatever gun bills come out of the legislature and perhaps signed by the governor don't necessarily compromise what they're doing. There's a lot of other stuff going on as far as education is concerned. Talk about that dynamic.
So two things. Let me backtrack really quick to the armed presence on campuses. And Leah mentioned it. We have a program called the School Resource Officer Program. It's been in place for decades nationally. It's a great program. It's a program that's worked, and it's a program that's been gutted in terms of funding over the past 3 to 4 years. We need to restore and increase funding for that, along with mental health planning, or mental health care, I should say, and some gun law reform. I'm going to be releasing a full proposal this Wednesday that covers all of these areas, and I'm going to be really taking this head on because it's something we have to do in this state. In terms of education funding as a whole, they've been gutted for the past several years. There's no doubt about it. We need to find funding for education, need to find funding that's dedicated for education, and we need to give schools the ability to use that funding for whatever they think is best for their local situation. But anybody that claims we're funding education to the degree that they need to be funded or they've restored funding, that is just not correct. We have to put more money back in our schools.
Well, I'm not only hearing that, I'm hearing that we are, out of the general fund, spending more than the national average on education. Right now.
You know what? When you look, if we're talking about on average, and we're looking at the fact that we're still 48th in the state, that's a big concern. You're looking on average of the amount of per pupil spending that we have. That's also very low. All these different things that are coming forward, plus we have so many mandates, unfunded mandates, that have went forward for our schools. That's a huge concern. We have the move, you know, making sure that children are ready to read by the time they get to third grade. That's about $45 million prize tag of where we're going to where are these funds going to come from so that we can have the children ready. But yet districts on the same side have had to cut back on full day kindergarten and but in order to be ready to read by the time you're in third grade, it seems like we would be getting ramped up to make sure that we have full day kindergarten and districts not having to make those particular choices. So I don't agree.
Well, again, we're hearing that not only spending more than the national average, but that it's bad press to continually say that we are gutting education. It's not good for Arizona.
Look, okay, people that say we shouldn't be talking about the bad things in Arizona or only focus on the good things, I have a feeling Ken Wesenhunt said the exact same thing to Michael Bidwell. Let's focus on the 5 wins, not the 11 losses. Guess what? You have to focus on the bad things when they outweigh the good things. The school system in this state right now is not getting enough money. And I'm not sure about that claim in terms of the general fund percentage. It may or may not be true, But the bottom line is most other states have different mechanisms for funding their schools, and they put more money into schools from a variety of sources, whereas we do not do that. And to Leah's point, our per-student spending is the lowest in the country, and pretty much everybody agrees on that. Any valid source agrees with that. We've got to fund our schools. And we've enacted a bunch of reforms the past few years. They're all going to start coming online the next few years. So let's give the schools the money they need now to enact those reforms and see what happens next. But we've got to fund our schools in order to see any type of performance enhancements.
All right, we'll stop it right there. Good discussion. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
All right, wonderful.